Good evening and welcome to everybody. Let me wish all the women here on International Women's Day and all the best for a new beginning to your financial life. We're delighted to have none other than Sujata Kabraji, who is one of the best known wealth managers in Mumbai today. For those of you who are at Moneylife Foundation's workshop for the first time, a few facts. We are just over 3 years old. We turned three on February 6th this year. We have a membership of 21,500. The membership is free, and I guess our work is beginning to make an impact because our membership has trebled in the last 1 year. I'm not going to say anything more. I think we need to get cracking with the workshop. But before we do that, I'm requesting my colleague Serafina, who is our project coordinator, to introduce Sujata.
Good evening, everyone. I am honored to introduce Ms. Sujata Kabraji on International Women's Day. Ms. Sujata Kabraji is an MBA and an alumni of the Symbiosis Institute of Business Management of Pune. She now heads her own financial advisory firm, which she started after over 8 years in the tough and male-dominated stockbroking business. So we can't think of a better person to conduct this special program today on International Women's Day. Friends, please welcome Ms. Sujata Kabraji.
I think they've been too kind in the, you know, little write-up and stuff that they've done. I'm not anywhere near that. And actually, that's exactly why I'm here, because I want to, you know, the topic is what mistakes women make. So the first thing I hear, especially when you're young, is what is age, you know, and I said it too. And anyone agrees with this? Did you? Yeah, right? Okay, so I wasn't the only one. Okay, I have another confession to make. You know, when my grandmom was, she lived with us, and till she reached the age of 97, she never wore glasses, and she said, men never look at women who wear glasses. But I'm trying to change that. So, this is what I want to just share with you. You know, I used to eat out a lot when I was in my early 30s. My husband and I would have a kind of routine. Friday nights, jazz by the bay. Sunday brunch, trattoria. And once a week, we'd go for a movie. Can anyone guess in the 90s what this would cost me in a week? 2,000. Any other guesses? 1,000. Okay. I'm going to repeat all that we did. We went to Jazz by the Bay. There was an entry. We went to Trattoria, which was Sunday brunch, and we do a movie once a week at least. 1,500. 4,000, 500 for all three? No, what's my total in a week that I spent? You guys, come on. No, I heard a 3,000 somewhere. Put your hand up. Yeah. Okay, 2,800 is the figure that we'd spent every week. And if at that time in my life, somebody had sat me down and said, listen, 1 week, why don't you stay home, read a book, go for a swim, go for a walk. I just said, my friends are going to abandon me if I don't go every week. Okay, so I'm not here to tell you what you should or shouldn't do. But I just want to say that if someone had sat me down and said, okay, 2,800 if you didn't spend once a week, okay, and you put that away, and then look at yourself when you're 60, how much would you have? And it would be 2 crores, 50 lakhs. So I'm not sure that I would have followed the advice, but you know, in those days, 2 crores, 60 lakhs was a lot of money, and it's not, I mean, not as much now, but you know, it would have been interesting. So, if there's anyone who's a mom here, a grandmom, a grandfather, a father, or if you're young enough and you're in your 30s and you think this is good advice, then let me tell you what I feel would help. First, just start with tiny steps. Jot down where you're spending money. Then ask yourself, is there any one small thing that you can cut out? Okay, without it making you feel like a loser. Oh, you know, if I don't do this, my friends are not going to talk to me. Stuff like that. Then, for the first month, just put that amount away into a recurring deposit, a fixed deposit, whatever the thing is. And then, if it didn't pinch, then from the next month, just set up an auto debit from your bank account. Once it goes out of your bank account, it's not there. So you won't spend it. And then you'll have 2 crore 60. Okay. The next one is... yikes. This is just, if you want to remember in one line what I said in many, many words. I have verbal diarrhea, sorry. Little strokes fell great oaks. So that's the one line you can take away. Anyone has life insurance? Yes? I think the number of hands are too few. Come on, that's it. Okay. How many of you who have life insurance have someone depending on them? Like, aha, there go the hands. Very few. Okay, basically what I want to say is that you're not smart. Your insurance agent is smart. Basically, if you remember that insurance is a protection, it's not an investment, okay? Then you'll ask yourself questions like, do I really need it? And if I need it, who am I protecting? So, you know, you'll have your friendly accountant in your office telling you, "Arre, just put this money in insurance. Because you'll save taxes." So you're very smart. You say, yeah. Here, take my check. 20th of March, 22nd of March. Take it. I'll save 6,000 rupees. I'll save 10,000 rupees. But there are many other options which will make you more money. So question yourself whether you need insurance. If you're single with no dependents, or you're not the main contributor to the family income, then think twice about insurance, life insurance. And the other thing, which I want to make it really simple because even I get confused. Basically, there are many types of insurance. Just remember the word term insurance. That's your man. Try not to go for the other types, because they're very expensive and they don't give you the same return that term will give you. So I keep forgetting to press this thing. When you see that little Venn diagram, it just try and remember that picture. Expensive insurance, lousy investment, and that's the intersection. So be careful when that insurance agent comes and tells you, bye. He's the one making the money, not you. Any of you in corporate jobs? Yeah? If there were guys here, there'd be many, you know, working guys. I think a lot of guys have corporate jobs. And nowadays, employers cover you really well with health insurance. And that's great. But I have a little story to tell you. And I think some of you will relate to the story. I have a friend called Sheetal. And there is a Sheetal here, but it's not the one I'm referring to. She's a friend of mine, and she worked for a well-known Indian company since she was about 24. The group basically covered her for 5 lakhs and her parents for 3 lakhs, and that made her really happy. Then in 2008, the company went through a bit of a rough patch, and they offered some women and men voluntary retirement. Now, her folks were kind of not keeping too well, so she decided to quit, take the golden handshake, and start a small business out of home. And then at that point, she was around 47, and very sensibly, she decided, okay, now I don't have medical cover, so I'll get my own. Now, over the age of 45, you have to do medical tests. So she said, no problem, I'm fit, I'll do it. And she was diagnosed with diabetes. Now, the company is not saying no, they will give her health insurance, but it's costing her an arm and a leg. Okay? And it doesn't cover diabetes-related diseases, which many of you will know. There are a lot of, diseases which are related to diabetes. Now, you know, I think those of you who are in corporate jobs, I think you should just be aware that that's not enough. Many guys quit their jobs and start off on their own when they're in their mid-40s because they want to try something on their own. So just remember that, you know, it's good to have your own. There's another, I'm really going to belabor the health, issue a bit, because I think we're not all aware, and I make the same mistake, that prices and costs of medical care are skyrocketing. What cost you in 2007 if you did a cataract, average in India was 16,000, now it's 24,000. If you do an angiograph, it used to be 14,000, now it's 22,000. If you do a bypass, 1,65,000 officially, and now it's about 2,35,000. That is just for the surgeon. Then you have other costs, you know, the guys who assist him, you have your, hospital stay, all that. So please stay abreast of what costs are. You know, next time you visit someone in a hospital, just ask what, you know, a cataract is, whatever is, you know, likely to happen to you, which you don't know. I have another little story. I have a friend's mom, Anita. She's about 72, and recently she had her knees replaced at Breach Candy, and the total cost was 5,15,000. She spent about a week there. Her insurance cover was 5 lakhs, so she had to pick up the balance, which was about 15% of the cost of the replacement. So I'm making basically 3 points here, and I'm saying that, you know, health can actually eat into your wealth. So make sure that you have enough insurance. Keep checking every year what costs are. They're growing geometrically at about 10%, 12%. Make sure you have private cover as well as medical cover, and keep some money aside. Call it your health compensation fund to pick up the balance 15-20%, which insurance companies will not pick up. Okay, so you can have your own little name for it, but what I'm saying is it's an emergency fund which will top up what is not picked up by your insurance company. I want to give you a little idea. If you're single and you start young and you put away 15,000 rupees an annum once a year, then by the time you're older, in your 60s, you'll have about 15 lakhs saved, and that would be enough for the moment. Okay, I'm trying my hardest not to bring numbers into this thing, but unfortunately I haven't. Okay, this I've heard a lot. Basically, the answer is, darling, there's a cross, just sign, no?
Okay, and we sign. So, quick, I want to know, does anyone know where all you sign? Where are the things you sign? Like, when you're starting a bank account? Come on. Any other places where you have joint stuff with brothers, fathers, husbands? Shares, property, yes. Lockers. Sorry? Yes, very good. Not in my list. Debu, I think that deserved the prize. Who said wills?
That deserves the prize.
She's standing up. Where else? Any other places that you sign? Yeah, FDs, real estate. Come on, give me one that I don't have in my list.
Mutual funds.
Mutual funds, yes. Property, real estate, done. Bank lockers, she said, yeah. Shares, you said. Okay. Hey, I know more. I only one missed in my list. Okay. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that we tend to just trust blindly and sign on the dotted line. There are some things that weren't mentioned, like bank overdrafts. If your husband's in business, he's looking for an OD facility and he comes and says, you know, my business is doing well. What I'm trying to say is, I'm not telling you not to sign. I'm not telling you that, you know, tell your husband, your father, your brother, no, I don't trust you, I'm not going to sign. I'm just saying this. He won't love you any less if you ask him, what am I doing? Explain to me. Okay? And I just want to give you a little background on, you know, this has happened actually to someone I know who's very dear to me. Her name is, I've changed her name, so I'm going to call her Maya Kapadia. She was married to an engineer from IIT Pawai. She was actually my batchmate. Very smart girl, great paycheck, and she used to basically just focus on work. And in those days, there's no ECS and auto credit and debit and none of that. So paycheck haath mein leke, she would give it to her husband and say, here. She didn't know how to fill in a payslip. When she wanted to withdraw money, she didn't know how to write a check. And this is like one of the top of my batch, really smart girl. Now 10 years later, and a baby later, he found greener pastures. The pasture was young, sexy, and hot. He lost his job because his focus was elsewhere. And this pretty young thing was about 24, not earning very much. So, Mr. Midlife Crisis kept the pretty young thing under his hat and continued to get Maya to sign on that cross. Then in 2009, she got a Dear John letter. Does everyone know what a Dear John letter is? Okay. Basically, you know, the result of reading that letter was that she was husbandless and penniless. And she had a 5-year-old daughter to bring up. So, trust, but understand what you're signing. Love with your heart, but sign with your brain. Do I really need to explain this one? How many of you buy gold or want to buy gold? There we go. Okay. There are quite a few who like gold, so do I. And I'm not saying gold is bad. It's not.
Ma'am, you can buy gold coins and bars, and the bars you can turn to gold. There's no tax on
Right. So that's what I'm saying. I know. That's what we were talking about earlier. But what I'm trying to say is that, you know, if you had a hen that laid golden eggs, would you only eat those golden eggs, or would you have a backup hen somewhere? To dukaan se lenge ya kahan tabhi lenge? You have a backup, right? So gold is not a bad thing, but I don't think that it should be your only egg in the basket. You can't live on gold eggs all the time. So, you know, if I were to ask you, what's anyone? Now, this is numbers, but they're really easy, so don't blank out, okay? What is 8 minus 9? Right. What's 9 minus 9? What's 12 minus 9? Now, if that, if the first figure was to represent what you were earning, and the second figure was to represent inflation, which one would you choose? Which of those options would you choose? Right. I think universally it's 12 minus 9, right? Anyone wants minus 9? Hands up. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that if you have multiple eggs, and each egg is in a different basket, if one basket drops, you're not left minus, okay? You'll have two, three other baskets which are giving you either zero or something plus. So please look at what you have, look at what your family has, and divide it up into baskets, okay? Normally, if you talk to some very suave bank manager, suited, booted, someone, Ranjit isn't wearing one of those, he will talk to you and he'll say, asset allocation. You must do asset allocation. What the hell is that? You know? It's really just this. Just think about a basket full of eggs and say, if I drop it, kya hoga? No breakfast. So, have 3-4 baskets and put a few eggs in each basket. Okay? I think I missed some. Right? Anyone thinks this way? I have a question. Are there any women here who know what their tax slab is? What's your tax slab? You know, is it? Yeah. I'm thrilled to hear this. Absolutely thrilled. Because this is the one thing that, I mean, and I'm making a confession here. Till I was, I think, you know, in my early 30s, I didn't know tax slab had any impact on me. I would go to my CA, say, here, take my bank statement, and you tell me how much to write on my check. My job is to earn. Your job is to do this calculation. And I never asked which slab I was in. So here I have a story of someone, she's under 30. Works with Ernst & Young, and she's in their audit department. She's like a CPA, very smart girl. She lives at home, so no rent and free food. She's from the financial world, so like a good girl, every month she saves. And not only does she save, but she, not like us, like putting it into the savings I've saved. She actually moves it to an FD the day her salary comes in. And last year, her FDs were giving her 10%. It's because she's, you know, very highly qualified, she saved over a crore of rupees before she's 30. So, don't you think she's really smart? Yes? No? True. It's great, but for the tax man. Not for her. You know, after tax, on that 1 crore, she would earn 7 lakhs. Sorry, 70 lakhs, sorry, my mistake. I told you there were butterflies. So basically, all that she needed to do was to move from one product to another, where she would get net of tax a higher rate. Okay, that's all. So she'd come to the point where she saved. But you can save smart. So how do you kind of save smart? For that you have to know first, what is your tax slab? Okay, just charm your accountant. That's all. And you have only three choices, 10, 20 or 30, not very hard to remember. And then when Ranjit comes to you and tells you, invest here, you have to ask him the question, what is my net of tax return? Bas. It's not hard. Okay? And so my young friend loves me to death because now she has all that money to buy her Jimmy Choo's. This is your solution. Make your CA and your financial advisor fall in love with you. So since we're talking about love, women live longer than men. These are statistical realities. And this is something I've heard. I'm not a mom, but I have a lot of friends who are moms, whose kids I love dearly, and they're all sitting in the audience over here. So this is what I keep hearing. Mom, I need that iTouch 5. Please, please, I need it. Then I've also heard my friends' husbands, who are also friends, say, Jan, I've got a great bonus. Let's get a BMW 7 Series now. And then the dog. Look what I got you. This is what you do. Spa treatment voucher at Paws and Jaws. Now, all this is great. And here I want to sort of pause and tell you a story. Again, you know, these are friends and I'm trying not to mention names. So if I mention a name, I didn't say it. Okay. So I have a friend who is currently nameless. She basically retired from a very well-paying job with a multinational. She had a very good salary. She's a really smart babe. And she's a single mom with two kids. She had to return to her parents' home because her marriage fell apart. And she was still in her early 30s. Her parents were real darlings. And, you know, they were there they lived for a while. They reached a ripe old age. But unfortunately, they were both ailing from the age, from when she was, 45. She's a loving daughter. She spent every paisa paying their hospital bills, IRs to look after them, and spending the day at work. Her kids' education, and she really never thought of retirement. I mean, you get into this rut, you keep going, you keep going, you keep going, and you know, retirement looks very far away. Not only that, she personally loved entertaining her extended family. So, you know, her sister, her cousins, they'd come from out of Bombay and stay with her for 3 months, and she'd take them out for great meals and movies and plays and whatever. And then once in a way, when all this got too much, she'd go out on a shopping spree. Last year when she retired, she got retirement lump sum from her company, and she got 35 lakhs. Now, she's a South Bombay girl. Can anyone tell me when you retired, you know, 60 or 58, is 35 lakhs going to be enough for the next 30 years? Right. So, what I'm trying to tell you is, make sure when you're old, you have the money to party on. You know, when everyone's gone, you will still be there. So, because women live longer than men, kids have their own lives, and even turtles die. Make sure you indulge your family, but every time you do something for them, do something for yourself. Even if it's to go out and have a foot massage. But then make sure that before that foot massage, something's put away for your future. You know, this is not something that only women say, men say it too. But women make a lot of drama out of it. Oh my God, I can't look at it. I'll vomit. So, you know, I don't have a solution for this one. But just to give you an idea about the importance of paperwork. I went to St. Mary's School in Pune, and I have a school friend, and she's still one of my dearest friends. She was married, and when she was about 34, pregnant with her second child, she lost her husband. He had a massive stroke, and there was only 700 rupees in the bank, because she was like, my husband cushioned me. She and her husband partied all the time. And then she found an insurance policy. She went to the insurance agent and she said, you know, what do I do? So he said, don't worry, ma'am. It's a big policy. I'll get you the money. No, she didn't get it, because he had forgotten to pay the premiums. And it had been too long for it to be revived. So, I mean, the rest of her story still brings tears to my eyes, because her mother-in-law threw her out on the street. She had 700 rupees, and her husband was a businessman. People took advantage, and there was a queue of people coming to tell her, but you know, he borrowed money from me, so now give it back. Maybe there were some true, but definitely not all of them. And she spent, I think, 5 or 6 years of her life like a very honest woman, working herself to the bone and returning this money. Okay? I have another story to tell, which is not as sad. I've been telling you these sad stories, so I'm going to tell you a happy one now. You know, my mom travels a lot. But I'm very lucky, because I have a stand-in mother. For many years, she had 3 Godrej cupboards lying in the house. Each cupboard had a stack of dog-eared papers lying very neatly, put in brown envelopes. Very neat. And every time she opened those cupboards, she would feel guilty. Oh, I don't know what to do with this. Then one day, she had the cupboard open, and the raddi wala told her, "Bhai, ये सब बेच दो ना, 500 रुपया मिल जाएगा." So she thought about it and she said, you know, I don't know whether I should do it, because I've kept it. She had got it from her parents. So it was like legacy. Even if it was just paper, it was legacy. So she called up someone and you know, somebody came and had a look at the papers, and they were all Tata shares. There was stacks of them. It took 3 years to sort, demat, and the value ran into crores. What can I say? She no longer takes the bus. So, I don't have an answer. We had to go through those stacks of papers. I actually felt like vomiting at a stage looked at them and I said, never, never, kabhi nahi hoga. But it happened. And there is no escape. So I'm going to use the cliched phrases, bite the bullet, roll up the sleeves, dig right in, scream for help if you want, which is what she did. You know, bribe someone or keep chocolates handy and stuff your face. Whatever rocks your boat, just do it. Okay? So, now, how many people here have a will in place? Wow. Sujata, you have been, I think, you and Devu have definitely got Bombay rocking on wheels with all that effort that you've put in. So, there are a lot of people who are regulars, and I can see some of them putting up their hands. So, this is something that, you know, we all kind of know, right? What's mine is his, not the kids, till I die. What's his is mine. But what is the real truth, you know? This is, you know, the law. What's his is not yours entirely. It goes to all these people, yeah? Please see. So, you may sit at home, you may be looking after the kids, but for those who are looking and it's not clear, I just want to read what it says. If you don't have an estate plan in place, the law of succession takes over. The transfer of your assets may be smooth or could be mired in legal disputes. The process can be lengthy and expensive. And here's how your legacy will be divided according to the first order of inheritance. So basically, if the husband dies, it goes equally to the son, the daughter, the widow, the mother, the children of the pre-deceased, son or daughter, widow. I mean, it just goes on. And your money is basically stuck till you sort this all out. So, this is just an example. If there are any Muslims here, this is how it gets divided. I wish I had the Bawa laws. I don't. I can see Bawas over here. So, this is what I want you to do. There are many things that will come to your mind. How can I ask my husband to do this? How can I, my father is 75 years old or 80 years old, how can I tell my father, make a will? I felt it too, you know, but my father was, and mother, very enlightened. What they did was they wrote a will. They shared it with, I have two siblings, they shared it with us and said, if you have an objection, make it now. Don't fight after we're gone. Okay, so what I'd like to say is, you know, whoever it is you have to tackle, just make it happen. And I believe in this, not everybody does, so this is your personal choice. But after it's written, you should probably share the basic ingredients with the executor and other beneficiaries and make sure that there's no trouble later. Did I miss one? No. Okay, this I have heard over and over and over again. I can't deal with numbers. What is 2 plus 2? I don't care. Okay? You can rest assured, and this I want you to listen to very carefully. I did my bachelor's major in statistics. Without a calculator, I still look like that. Okay? So, basically, before I get to this one sec, I want to tell you this, and I'm a living witness to this. If you throw mental maths at me, I freeze. I totally freeze. I can't do it. But planning your financial lives is not about numbers. All you have to do is just make a blueprint. A blueprint needs words. It does not need numbers. All of us want to get married. We have children. We all enjoy our lives, spend money. We all retire. We all holiday. It's normal stuff, right? Just write down what you want your life to be all about. And then find someone who's good at numbers. Even if it means they have to take a calculator and can't do mental maths. And explain in words what you want your life to be financially. It's how you communicate which is important. Then learn a little bit along the way and monitor regularly what's going on. So you have to ask the question. You can't, remember the blind trust one? You can't blindly trust people. You have to monitor. And then once in a way, if there's a change in your life, something's happened, you have to course correct. You have to tell the person who's helping you that, boss, this is what's happened. Now, kya karna hai? Not that hard, right? So, I want to end this with this. So basically the message is what was the last few words in that thing. Change your words and it'll change your life. I want to thank all the lovely women who have come here to support me. And also very specially Aditi. She is from, you know, DSP BlackRock. She's actually with the power of her organization set up a little wing called Wnvestor, which is basically for women who are experts in the financial field to help women who need that help. Because one of the things which I didn't say here is women don't like to display their ignorance to men. They're okay with saying to another girlfriend or to a woman that, hey, I don't know how to do this. Can you help me? And this is exactly what she's trying to do. She's trying to sort of get women who are advisors in the financial world to reach out to women who need the help. And she's done a lot of things. She ran free workshops in her office, gave her beautiful office space and got some of us to come and invited women from anywhere to come and talk about specific issues. She's done a lot of events like this where the focus has been women. And I think it's going to be something you should watch out for. So when you see the word Wnvestor, wise woman, invest, I think she deserves a big hand.
Your topic was the 10 financial mistakes women are likely to make. Yeah, when you look at the finances, it's the money. But then there are other assets which are even lot bigger nowadays in cities like Bombay, which are the property, the residential place you stay in. And here the danger is not from frauds, strangers or Dawood or anybody. The threat comes from your close relatives. And so when you allow your relatives to live in your flat, how do you protect that? Are women likely to make mistakes and pass them on to their children, or allow them to stay there and create a stake or a right to live there, and where the older woman is jeopardized? So are you aware of any women who are likely to or who have made such mistakes, and how to protect?
It's a very good question. It's partly law and not entirely my area of expertise, but yes, sir, I do know of such cases, and it's one of the prime reasons why I have so much sympathy towards women. I have seen this happen. A will is actually a good starting point. So if the man writes a will, makes it very clear that the property goes to the wife, then at least you have a foot in the door. There may be legal issues. Today in Bombay, all wills where property is concerned have to be probated. And I know people in the room who are in this position actually. So yes, it's a lot that goes on. But like I said, you have to start with a will.
But it comes after the death.
Yes.
People are harassed even while they're living.
Yes. So I don't have an answer. People are people. Sujata has the answer. There are NGOs that have been set up. There are helplines available where people offer help free of cost. So if you know anyone in that situation, contact Sujata and she'll be able to give you the numbers. But please do help if you know someone. Yes.
Hi, Sujata. We, after partition, 1947 partition happened, there's a lot of traumatized people, first generation, and there are people who are single children and they are girl child. And I feel that the problem on the single woman and people who have had a migratory history, the responsibility and the challenges are very peculiar to a single woman or in that category. And I think some special work needs to be done by all the women on the Women's Day, that this issue should be taken up, that single girl child should be given some leverages and adjustments. And for example, the Cooperative Housing Society Act, the new law that is coming up, I believe, which is under process, bill is being passed, is that you can be dishoused if you've not put maintenance for 1 year.
Yes.
Now this can happen with single women because there are too many responsibilities. So, I mean, a single girl child should be given some exception and leverage. So if you could all take it up, please, is my suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you for your suggestion. It's very valid. Anyone else? Sorry.
You mentioned that the deposits, the after-tax benefit isn't that much.
Yes.
So is there anything at a vague level, can you suggest some
yes,
things that
yes,
would help?
Yes. Okay. Please, everybody listen. Mutual funds offer a product called fixed maturity plans. What they do is they borrow money from you and they lend it often purely to a bunch of banks. So you have to be careful, you have to ask the right question. But if you use fixed maturity plans, the maximum tax you pay is 10%. So if you're in the 30% bracket, you will end up saving 20% in tax. There's some side benefits also, which is you get something called capital losses on paper, which actually help you if you're selling a house. Okay. Yes, good question.
As a lay person, honestly, I really don't know how to manage the money part, you know. If insurance is not, you invest into insurance company, that's not a good deal. If you invest into FDs, that's not a good deal. Is there any NGO or something that where we could get empowered to understand whether you should invest into bonds or, you know, basic things, you know,
yes.
How to look at it, and
yes.
Because this is our weakness, you like to look at good figures, but you can't manage that figure, you know.
Yeah, there is. I have a nice answer. You're Bombay-based, right? Right. So you could start with Sujata's foundation, Moneylife. They run workshops. Educate yourself. It's not about numbers. It's about basic concepts. Just now you saw her question. Isn't that an alternative to fixed deposits? You heard my answer. Not difficult. Really, it's about asking questions. So, you know, but choose responsibility. You could even contact, Sujata's organization is one. DSP is another. They still run these free workshops from time to time. You can email them and ask them to run one if you don't spot, you know, wading through a website is sometimes beyond me. So,
register on our website.
Yeah. You can register on the website and then write what you're looking for. And, Aditi has a team that their responsibility is to reach out when you reach out. So there are options, and the internet is a very powerful tool. You could ask the question there. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Sujata, and thanks for making it really, really simple for everybody. Let's all give her a big hand. And as I said earlier, all this is possible because of Aditi. I'm glad you're here. May I request Aditi to give a small memento to Sujata? Thank you very much.